wait for you guys to start coming in. I've got a pretty cool lesson for you guys today, which we're gonna go over soon. We're gonna talk about infighting, throwing the more traditional tools like the elbows. We're gonna talk about putting the knees in there, some like punching and boxing drills, but also how to mix it all together and some principles of being on the inside. So a lot of the lessons that we've done so far have been on the outside for long jabs, long crosses, footwork, trying to work the angles. Hello, everybody. Now today we're gonna be working from a much tighter, much shorter range, right? And I'm gonna demonstrate first the elbows for you. So when you're in close, some tools that work well are these elbows, right? That come from all different directions, just like your punches can come from all different directions. So the first elbows that we're gonna work are the snap elbows, right? So you have to give credit. See, Muay Thai became a very popular art here in America, especially in New York, but across America. And Dan Misanto, which is one of the Jeet Kune Do guys, obviously one of the more famous Jeet Kune Do guys, he brought Ajahn Chai, Master Chai, from Thailand and started doing seminars in America. And fun fact, New York Martial Arts Academy was the first school to teach Muay Thai in Queens, and the first school to teach Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in Queens as well, which I always thought was pretty cool. But there's a lot of elements of Muay Thai in our curriculum, like the elbows, which I'm gonna quickly demonstrate and I'm gonna break down, right? So you're here, right, just smashing the elbows. That was my back elbow. So I'll do one at a time now. Just like that, turn the hips, turn the core, turn the shoulders, right? So that was my rear elbow, it's like a left hook. And your shoulder turns through. The elbow, this elbow is supposed to be almost completely, if not completely, horizontal. And you always cover your eyebrows, not to get too gruesome, but if you're this close, right? You don't want to get hit in the eyebrow, because then if you get a little cut or a big cut, God forbid, the blood will go in your eye. If you can't see, you can't fight, right? So when you hit somebody with an elbow, on the eyebrows, bridge of the nose, the eyes, right, just right underneath the eye, the eye socket, the jaw, of course, and the temple all does the trick. So, you know, if you're just turning the feet, turning the hips, turning the core, right, we'll do some different combinations with the elbows, but, you know, sometimes you work your way in, you throw like a basic jab, cross, hook, and you step in with that rear elbow, and it chips. It chips. Master Chai used to say that Teddy and I were talking about it. See, Teddy and I were talking about like chipping the elbow, just doing it nice and fast. And we're also talking about entries into these elbows. So obviously this is infighting, this is close. So we're here, right, just like that, firing the elbows. Now you can also fire the lead elbow and then work your dips to the up elbows and do a bunch of cool stuff. So let's say you fire this lead elbow, dip, up elbow, right? A little fancier, kind of a fun one. So slicing, up elbow. You can even throw the spin elbow if you want to get real fancy. So let's do a cool one. Bop, bop, bop. When you spin, look over your shoulder with your eyes, right? So just like a fun one. So again, jab, slice, over, pop, just like that, on the bag, pop, 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 just like that, jab, slice, slice, wee, right over the top. So, elbows are cool tools, right? So we did, let's count the ones that we did. One, two, three, under. Now, another powerful elbow, very powerful elbow, the down elbow. You try to come as close from 12 o'clock to 6 o'clock as possible, right? So think of just clock, 12 to 6, over the top. So you're there, over, over. So you start putting the elbows together, right? Just like you throw your hands, most practitioners actually like throw their hands pretty well. Like, they come in, they start training, you're able to throw like a double jab, and nice combination because we work our hands. Elbows should be the same. They should be one right behind the other. So it's like, let's say I went down elbow, snap elbow, right? The Focus Master is actually perfect for elbows, just like a heavy bag, but this is actually better, right? So you just, right? And these are nasty shots. You can hit like that. So I just want to show you something. You know, we were talking about that Conor McGregor quote, precision beats power. It's like, imagine, just touch the pointy part of your elbow, like massage it with your hand. Imagine that part just slices into somebody's face in the wrong part of their face. It's very nasty, right? Elbows can also come in this type of an angle. Bah, bah. Upwards elbows. Huh, 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 huh. And you're always covering, 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 right? These are nasty shots, and remember, it's hips and core, so when you fire these, hips and core, hips and core, right? Just smashing and blasting, because when you fire at this range, the elbows, right? Think about it, the bad guy can throw elbows back at you. So you want to be first, you want to be vicious, you want to be often, and you want to end it, right? You want to end the encounter, right? Another place that elbows happen pretty often is from the clinch position. So imagine I'm here, I'm on the balls of my feet, I'm in the clinch. I have a traditional plum. Now I'm moving the guy, bang, maybe I'm kneeing him, bang. So I'm going from pulling to elbowing to headbutting, perhaps back to kneeing to tugging. And I'm sandwiching, I'm grabbing his head and elbowing, then clinching, grabbing, elbowing, elbowing, trying to make it miserable for the guy. Again, the Focus Master is cool to use here because you can grab it, you're moving, throwing your skipping knees, which we'll do later, but bah, 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 shipping those elbows, bah, 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 just smashing them. And if you've ever seen somebody actually get elbowed, whether it's an MMA fight, a street fight, or like a Muay Thai or a kickboxing competition, it's vicious. Because the elbows do one of two things. They either cut the person, sometimes they just cut like a knife. Other times they smash and they make like big hematomas, which can close somebody's eye, break their eye socket, break their jaw, break their nose, and they're nasty tools. So these elbows, like even sometimes you're hearing any touch, just sideways, right over the top, just sideways over the top, sideways over the top, sideways over the top, sideways over the top, and it's rolling, rolling, rolling. These are nasty infighting tactics. And for those of you that are familiar with trapping, this is also a good place. Imagine you guys got a pillar, I get my hands on the pillar, I start yanking his hands down, so like the hands are here, he starts yanking my hand down and elbowing. My hand's here, he yanks my hand down and elbows. What's up? Oh yeah! My man Cebu Carlos is in the house. What's up, Carlito? What's up, baby? I missed you. Oh yeah, so listen, we're going over elbows. So let me just catch up, can you see me?
Yes.
So we were doing like, pop, pop, pop. There's like the triple elbows down the middle, snap, the down elbow, and talking about infighting for self-defense, just to catch you up, okay? Okay, so everybody, especially YouTube, because you might not be able to hear him as well, but Instagram, I know you guys can hear him loud and clear. We have Cebu Carlos on the line, my senior. We're going to be talking about infighting and the elbows, right? So where we were was we're in this tie clinch. Boom. I got the guy. I'm throwing the knees. Bang. Now I let go for a second. I chip the elbow, chip the elbow. I come right back. So if I was here on this Focus Master, pop, just firing the knees and the elbows. Now remember, for self-defense, for the elbows is the same, right? But for the knees, you could always need the groin Most people in a self-defense situation won't have a cup, and even if they did, it wouldn't matter. You're gonna knee above the groin, right into the bladder, into the liver, in the chest as well, but not as good, and of course the face. So, but the big difference is if I'm controlling somebody in the clinch and hurting them, well now a lot of their skills go out of the window. What's up, super close? So, when you're inside, it's also important when you score with these elbows, you hit with that hard part right here, right? Not your forearm. What's up, Sigma? Not your forearm here, the hard part of the elbow, right? When you hit with your knees, never the soft part. Always the solid part of the knee, right? Because Conor McGregor said that really cool quote. He said, precision beats power, timing beats speed. So precision has two things. Precision on what I'm hitting you with, and precision on where I'm hitting you, right? So if that elbow comes right down the pipe, bah, and it hits you on the bridge of the nose, it's gonna shatter, because big stick break little stick, right? This big old bone is gonna break the eye socket. The nose, the jaw, right? And it just sucks, right? So sometimes another tactic, and I know Supercross likes this one. Supercross is gonna like this. Guys got pillar defense. You do posting. So you post on his pillar, then step right through. So again, you're here, you post on the pillar, stepping right through the guard. What do you think of that, Carlos? Yeah, so I like sometimes when the guy's got the pillar defense like this, they're very boxing centric, very good for boxing, because let me explain why that defense is great for boxing, bad for self-defense. So I got, you know, let me put the gloves on so you guys can see. When I have boxing gloves on, you'll see how different it is from the hands. And Daniel Santo actually talks about this, that the pillar defense doesn't work for self-defense when elbows are involved and headbutts and grappling. Don't worry, I got you. So, see this, I can cover the middle, I can cover the side, I can cover the body, right? But if you know how to trap, right, again, if somebody grabs my hand and pulls it down 1 inch, that elbow's gonna hit me right in the face. So like, imagine I yank right there, so yank right there, just tripling up the elbow if you have to, just bashing and smashing. Because people think, oh, trapping doesn't work, this doesn't work, that doesn't work. They used to say sidekicks don't work, but Kung Lee's indenting people's livers. He's breaking Ken Shamrock's arm with roundhouse kicks. Never say something doesn't work. It always works in a context. Now, one second. What's good about Jeet Kune Do is we have all the tools. What's up, Tim?
So, Shavant on Instagram asks, what do you mean by posting?
What do I mean by posting? That's a great question. So, the guy's got his arms up like this, and I put my hand on his guard, or even better, you put your fingers right near his eye, and you just open your hand, and you just walk and smash. So you're just walking, like almost like a long guard in Muay Thai here, but just walking, smashing, posting. So sometimes like I'll post, even with my back here, and just work the guard. So here, right there. So I'm posting, just chipping, right? Like just, I'm literally manipulating the guy's positioning, right? So Supercross, what do you think about that? Yes, yeah, so that's a great point, Super Carlos. So, you know, we see this in many arts, and it's not wrong. I won't go as far as saying it's wrong, but you get a jiu-jitsu man, and you fight a jiu-jitsu man, and then you go and try to learn jiu-jitsu. But then you're stepping into his world, right? Maybe you should learn how to wrestle to counter the jiu-jitsu man, to not be taken down. Let's say the guy's got a pillar defense like we're doing now. Maybe you see the pillar and you automatically go into boxing mode because that's what you saw in your boxing class. But maybe you should go into elbow mode and clinch mode and takedown mode, right? So what Supercross is saying is very smart is you have to go outside of the box. You can't fight he's doing this, I'm going to try to do exactly what he's doing, but better. That doesn't work all the time, because if you took a jiu-jitsu guy and you said, hey, put boxing gloves on him and let him get in there with me or somebody that knows what they're doing, I'm going to beat that guy up every day, right? Because I've taken the fish out of water. That's what you need to do as a jiu-jitsu practitioner. Guy's comfortable here, pull his arms off his face, smash him, and then start pulling his arms off his face, and then elbow him, right? So now what we're gonna do is talk about, we're in the clinch, maybe we threw some elbows, but the right way to throw the knees, and I'm gonna do it here on the Focus Master with the dummy here, right? So I have the clinch position, my feet, I'm on the balls of my feet, I kick one leg back, my knee comes through the middle, my kneecap is in his groin or his belly. I step, I skip, again. Step, skip, again. Step, skip, again. Again, 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 and again. And, you know, I've never met anybody who could take full power knees to the belly, let alone the groin. So it's a good strategy. Again, guys on the inside, he's thinking about boxing. You clinch his neck, boom, 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 boom. Repeated knees to the midsection and the groin, again, can do the trick. So, Steven Carlos, let me ask you a question. You know, and there's no better answer, but do you like more of the boxing-centric stuff on the inside? The elbows and the knees? Or, like, tell me your preference and why.
I prefer the elbows and the knees.
Yeah, you do.
You can hit to the groin, obviously. You can throw the elbows to the different angles of the person's face. Mm-hmm. You can cause a lot more damage. Just stay inside and punching someone who just simply punches and all that may not be the best thing. Mm-hmm. So I prefer the knees and I prefer the elbows. They're more damaging. And I believe they give you better results.
Absolutely. I agree with you wholeheartedly. And just add one more thing that I know you'll agree with is headbutts, right? You know, you're in there, you have the clinch. Imagine you lower your level. Boom, the crown of your head is in the face of the opponent. Very devastating, right, Steven Carlos?
Absolutely. Opens new opportunities as well.
Absolutely. And, you know, the last and final self-defense thing, at least for now, is the thumbs, right, towards the eyes. Right, you're in the clinch, boom, thumb in the eye, elbow, knee, headbutt. And it's just a continuous onslaught. You're never stopping. You can't rest in the clinch, especially in a self-defense situation. Because, like, let's say you're in a jiu-jitsu match, you can be in the clinch and rest because you're not going to get punched and, like, you know, foul tactics and all this stuff. But in a real situation, you either have to work and throw the person, hurt them with striking and foul tactics, or get out of there. There's no resting. So, I just want to reiterate that, again, those elbows, those knees, the headbutts, eye gouge is very devastating on the inside. And it's one of the reasons why we teach Jeet Kune Do, is because it not only has the technical stuff that you see on the outside, but, I'll answer that in a second, it also has a lot of the foul tactics and the vicious tools that you see on the inside, like the elbows and knees from Muay Thai, and the shin kicks as well. But also, we have footwork, head movement, and roving rhythm. So, what's the question?
So, someone's asking, how do you prevent people from taking you down from the clinch position?
That's a great question, right? So, I have a heavy wrestling and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu base. And I will tell you that when you're wrestling, you want to be in a lower stance, right? So, you have a lower center of gravity. Now, when I have the clinch, I'm a little bit more upright, obviously, right? And I'm flying knees at you consistently. But the other thing is, right from here, if I need to, bang, my hips will come down and I'll sprawl. Shoelaces down. So I'll be from here, boom, sprawling on you if I need to. Worst case. But the other thing is, don't forget, I have your neck, so I'm tugging you side to side and throwing vicious elbows, vicious knees. I have the wrestler in a position that he doesn't normally wrestle in. It's usually a single collar tie in wrestling with this hand free on the bicep or on the wrist or in an underhook. Double collar tie is more Muay Thai style, more of a striker's deal. And again, I've actually put wrestlers in this position and sometimes they freeze. The typical thing they teach you is to push the elbows up while you lower the level to hit the double, but it's not as easy as it looks because the knees are flying, the elbows are flying, and you're getting tugged around with that double collar tie. So It's a give and a take, but it's dangerous for both guys. Good. Any other questions?
Ramon is asking, is the post a form of probing?
Sure, it can be. The post can be a form of probing, but it's really to just get the guy flustered and mess up his guard, right? Because if you're having trouble with somebody's guard, you're going to get tired eventually because you're firing maybe full throttle and they're taking it and they're not getting hurt. So you have to be very, very careful when fighting somebody who has a very good post, a very good pillar defense, because if you don't know how to post and you don't know how to infight and bump them with the shoulders, a lot of times that defense is there to like wear you down a couple minutes in, so you just have to be careful with all that, right? Now, another thing is sometimes on the inside, you have to block the shots because they happen so fast that you couldn't roll, slip, dip, right? So yesterday we did a whole thing on slipping, dipping, rolling, catching shots. You can go back to that lesson if you want to see that. But today we're going to talk about the right way to block the punches if, God forbid, you end up in the middle of the exchange and, you know, you were throwing yourself, but the guy's throwing back, right? So the first one is going to be how to block right down the middle. And full disclosure on this, just please listen to what I'm saying. This is not a defense you want to use the entire time. This is a open moment. This is your insurance policy. And I think Super Carlos will agree that sometimes you need this defense to get you out of trouble, right? Super Carlos, the pillar defense for quick bursts. Yeah, so you're there. God forbid you got backed up. Let's go over the middle and the sides. So in the middle, look, my shields come strong. And I'm looking through this little hole, and I'm blocking. But I'm trying to just fire back. I'm never just taking 10, 12 shots. One, two, maybe three, and I'm firing right out of that shell, chin down, shoulders high, and I'm punching right out of it, right? So down the middle, fire back. Down the middle, fire back, right? Now, around the sides, you have to get your shoulder in front of your face. See, with the boxing glove, my glove can be in front of my face and my wrist can block, but not without a boxing glove and not outside of weight classes. So then I have to rock inside the circumference of the blow, raise my shoulder, so my shoulder goes where my face was. Let me repeat that. My shoulder goes where my face was. So my face is right here. My shoulder goes where my face was. So you're going to get punched in the shoulder really hard. And then you're going to come out punching from this pillar in the shell defense. Same thing on the other side. Hook's coming this way. Shoulder, and you ever hear the term roll with the punches? I would love to roll and get under. I just don't have enough time. I would love to roll and get under. I had a chance to roll. I didn't have a chance to get under. Bang, clipping them back. Bang, clipping them back. Bang, clipping them back. Bang, clipping them back. And I'll tell you a little trick with the shell of the pillar defense. You pretend like you have like almost like a cape on, or like almost like something you're putting over your shoulders. You round your shoulders in, chin comes behind your guard, you're looking through your brow, you're punching. You can weave, you can slip. You gotta be careful rolling with the knees, but you can dip and roll and pull back, but your arms are engaged. Now remember, again, this defense is there for short spurts. You do not wanna be fighting in the pillar for the entire fight. I promise you, you will end up getting hurt. You may hurt your partner, but you will hurt yourself as well because you're gonna eat a lot of shots. This is an impact-driven defense. It comes from boxing originally, but can be used for self-defense sparingly when you are in trouble, right? Last thing before I kind of pass it over to Temi, last skill that I'm gonna go over that you need on the inside is simply letting your hands go, because elbows and knees are great, but they're not as fast as the hands. So let's say we did a basic combination like uppercut, hook. So you fire fast uppercut, fire fast hook, rear uppercut, hook. And my shields are up, my knees are bent. Pop, 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 pop. So under, over, and I'm speed. Right? Let's change it. Under, hook. So speed, speed, pop. Speed, speed, pop. Speed, speed, pop. Right? Hook, uppercut, overhand. Right? Hook, uppercut, overhand. And I'm winging them. hook, uppercut, overhand. And I'm just smashing, and then after that overhand, dig, head, right? So jab, overhand, dig, head. One more time. Jab, overhand, digging the body, reloading the hips, smashing in with the last hook. One more time. Jab, over, dig, head, right? Last one. Jab, cross the body, hook to the head. Real basic, but it works. Jab, cross, hook. One more. Jab, cross, hook to the head. So last skill before I pass over to Subbutemi is simply letting your hands go on the inside. So I hope you guys had a good time. I'm gonna be back in a few. What's up?
So Ramon's asking, what is the most recommended knee defense?
Knee?
Yes.
So when somebody clinches you, that's a good question. First thing, you have to get one leg between their legs. So imagine someone clinched me, one of my legs is between their legs, and my hips are in. So I'm blocking the knees. Then I'm trying to re-pummel and get my hands on the inside, but sometimes I grab their hip almost like I'm gonna do a judo throw, but that's just to stop them from being able to pull back. Then I reach with this side, and then I re-pummel, right? If we're at range, getting out of the way. Who's pushing out of the way? If you're unattached, don't try to block it. Get out of the way, and then fire back right away. So that's a good question. Thank you so much, guys.
All right, guys. How are you doing, Carlos? Good, we're missing you. So, let's get right into it next. So, we were just talking about infighting, right? But now let's talk on how we work our way into, right, infighting range, right? There's long range, medium range, and there's close range. So let's talk about how to get myself into the clinch position, right, by setting it up with some tools. So let's get into our fighting stance. One of the things you can do is, you're at range, right? You're not as close to your opponent. You could either close the distance by throwing a kick, right? Front kick, hook kick, right? Inverted hook kick. Or you could close the gap by throwing your punches, right? Fire straight, you could fire cross, right? Depending on your range. So let's talk about starting with the kicks. So let's go over here. We're gonna throw a pendulum front kick, right? As I land my front foot down, I'm gonna come down with that rear downward arm, right? Then from there, I'm gonna take my lead hand. I'm just gonna shoot this hand in here. I'm gonna get one, two, and I'm tie up my opponent, and I just go skipping knees, going bam, 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 bam. Right, so what it looked like right here, going sideways, front kick. I come down with the rear downward arm, take my lead hand, tie him up, and I go leg, vicious knees. Again, when you're in fighting, you don't want to take your time and admire your work, where you go one, bam, and then you go one, two, and then you just stay there and you're just admiring your work. No, no, no. You want to tie up, you go right into the action. Bam, bam, you step off, you turn them around, bam, step off, go around, bam. And you're just controlling the person, moving the head around side to side to get the person off balance. If you let the opponent, right, once you got them in the clinch, let them recover. They're gonna start fighting against you, right? Trying to break the clinch, right? So you don't want to give your opponent any leverage, right? You want to take that away from the person. So you're going one, two, tie them up, bam, bam, bam. Get crazy, step off, turn it over, bam, step off, turn it over, bam. A little more power, right? So now let's talk about a punching combination. We go one, right? We go over the jab, but let's go with the straight, because again, we're a longer range. Go, bam, straight. You flip it over to a jab, rear hand goes, tie him up, rear knee, drop off to the side, bam, drop off to the side, bam. You could just take one of your hands, drop off, and go boom, right away, fade, downward elbow. Or use the other hand, bam, drop it right there, right? So again, straight knee, jab, rear hand ties up, bam. Skipping knees, bam, you drop off, bam, you drop off, bam, you shift the head off, boom, downward elbow right there. Well, let's say you're right here, right, you got the clinch, you take your right hand, drop off the side, bam, there you go, that snap elbow from there, right? So again, one more time, I'm here, zoom it off sideways, straighten, jab, rear hand goes, you tie him up, bam, bam. And again, you're quick. You don't want to go 1, 2, 3, taking your sweet time. No. Really fast. And then you go here. You step over. And you're moving the person around, right? So once you're in there, and see, Carlos, I know you're a fan of this, right? You have that famous saying, right? Sometimes you gotta cross over to the door of insanity, right?
Yeah.
Get and handle your business. Yeah. Wouldn't you agree?
Absolutely. One of my favorite things.
Yeah, right? So whenever you put your hands on someone, right? It's not meant to be nice, where you go 1, 2, and then right when you tie him up, you just looking at him like, maybe I've gone too far. No. See, what happens is when it's go time. There's no thinking about, oh, maybe I've gone too far. See, we think of it and look at it like this. If you were, right, walking with your loved ones or your family members, right, and someone comes out, puts out a weapon, right, starts problems with you, you're not gonna go, right, and be very sorry after what you have to do, right? You're gonna be more or less thinking, what am I going to do? What is it going to take for me to stop this person from hurting myself, right? Or hurting, right, my loved ones. Wouldn't you agree, Stephen Carlos?
Definitely. A person is hurting you or your family, that is not the time to be nice to that person. That's the time where you have to do what you have to do as quickly as possible to get out of the situation.
Absolutely. I couldn't have said any better than that, right? And again, you know, the only way you're gonna be able to pull some of these things off, right, or any of these things off in real time is by coming in and training, right? Obviously, I know the whole situation that we're going, right, we're in right now, we can't come in and train in class, right? But even when you guys are at home, you got a lot of free time, you know, hour or two, just getting your stance, right? Practice that footwork, shadow box a little bit, right? And, you know, there has been a couple of questions regarding to shadow boxing, right? And use your imagination. Picture someone in front of you would stop at anything, right? And won't stop at nothing, right, to hurt you. Try to imagine that, right? Use that, right? And just use that imagination and just let it run wild. So you're here, right? Imagine the person right in front of you. Exchanging blows, right? You're covering, you're, you know, slipping, you're weaving, you're throwing your tools, utilizing footwork, right? To make it more realistic. Because I promise you guys, the way you train is exactly how you perform out there. What do you agree, Steve Carlos?
I agree.
Right. Right. And I learned this from Steve Carlos. So you guys don't take it from me, take it from my senior, Steve Carlos. He's the one who pretty much helped me in my training since I started. And as young as I look, right, I started when I was 19, now I'm 25, and I have 2 and more amazing instructors who have pretty much been training me from day one. And to this day, right, I can always count on them whenever I need anything. Or I'm having trouble with certain footwork, I know that they're gonna be there to help me out, right? And that's what we want for all our students here as well, right? So if you're having a hard time, always feel free to come to myself or any of the other instructors I'm training for, right? Or even in school, to stop by and be like, hey, I have a question about this. We're never gonna say no. Is it that right, Steve Carlos? Absolutely. So now let's go with some more, right, combinations. So we're here, right? I'm in my fighting position, right? So again, the way I could close it again, I go for kick, I go for punch, right? So now let's talk about some follow-ups from after, right? I've heard the guy, right? Let's say you've heard him, right? It's not time to, you know, drop your guard. It's time to finish it, right? So right after you go bam, skip your knees, boom, you finish with that rear knee, right? You just take your rear hand, right, you just push the guy off, and then you go really quickly, right there, blow with your kneecap. So let's say, from the coming front kick, downward arm, you tie that guy up, skipping knees, boom, boom, you push the person to open up some distance between yourself and your opponent, and you finish off with that rear leg hook kick. Alright, so one more time. We're here. Front kick. Downward arm. Time up. One, two, three. Push. Bam. You go with that rear leg hook kick.
Question for Steve Carlos. Has Jeet Kune Do made your karate better, or have you completely left it behind since training in JKD? Good question.
Teach me only in my introductory lesson. So that from that moment on, I was like, this is exactly what I want to do for the rest of my life. And here I am today. It's been like 7, 8 years now being in this school now. And honestly, if I could go back and if I knew that this school was open from when I was in the school, I would have been training here instead of going to that after school program, right? Where they were teaching me karate. Because again, it's not practical. It only works for that system, right? And Jeet Kune Do teach you how to kick, how to punch, how to trap, how to grapple, and how to use the weapon from low, medium, close range without being limited, right? Because let's say I'm trying to punch a guy, right? And we're really far. I'm not gonna go step, step, punch, right? There are better ways to close the gap besides stepping. I can lunge at the guy, right? But let's say I'm really close, right? I'm trying to kick. Maybe sliding, kicking my knee leg is not the best option there. Maybe a stationary kick, right? Quick switch, right? Or even going rear knee, or if I have enough room, I slide in and throw a pendulum knee. And I'm able to throw what? A kick off a medium to close range, where back in karate, right, they wouldn't have taught me that. It would have been like it wouldn't work. So you have to what? Open up the gap and then throw it from there. Why go back or go back forward when I could just go from here and throw a simple rear knee, pendulum knee, stationary front kick or stationary hook kick or quick switch, right? So I have more options here. Same thing being said, when I'm closer, if I can't throw my hooks, I have elbows, right? They have shorter range but give more damage, right? Instead of being here and pulling a weak hook, I'm able to throw a more powerful shot by throwing a snap elbow, right? Now, if I'm out a little further away, I can't throw this, right, snap elbow. Okay, I can push in with my hook. So again, Jeet Kune Do has the answer to all problems. And wouldn't you agree as well, Super Carlos? There you go. So, all right. So now let's talk about some more finishers, right, off the clinch. So we're already in the clinch, right? Say I've already dealt a lot of damage, throwing skipping knees, I shifted that person's head off, throwing downward elbow with my rear hand, or let's say with my lead hand, right? I go from here, right? I got him back up. I could just go right here, go around, go into the rear naked choke. I could, if I want to get really nasty and break the person's neck, I just drop, right? Break their head, break their neck in the process, right? I could do stuff like from here, go into an underhook and go and pooter them. Now they're on the floor, and I could just go into an armbar from there. Or if I don't want to get on the ground, I can just stomp the guy's face, right? Stomp the body, and that's it. That's pretty much it. There's no more. I can go into a grounded pound and just go right here, hitting the guy after that footer, right? So there's many things you can do from there as well.
Look, question. So question for all three instructors. Do each of you see a martial art that can be fused with your JKD training that you're curious about?
So, I'm always asking, do we see any other
arts? I have an answer to that. Wrestling, it's already in the curriculum, because wrestling teaches you takedown defense when the person's already in on your hips or about to get there, and it teaches you how to take somebody down, God forbid, you were about to be taken down. There is also a Filipino martial art element, part of Jeet Kune Do because of Dan Santos' influence on the art. So like my father has a degree in Kali and Eskrima, so you'll see a lot of drills that resemble Kali, but then we break out of it and we JKD eyes, let me repeat that, we JKD eyes our weapon, as well as even the grappling. Like, you know, we have conversations with Stephen Paul all the time, well, how do I take this wrestling move and make it for the street? What moves in wrestling completely are irrelevant? And we built a curriculum for grappling around the centric idea that this has to be relevant for self-defense. You don't want to be on the bottom. You want to be on top, pounding and submitting and avoiding submissions. And if you are on your back, you want to scramble to get back up. So wrestling, definitely, and the screamers in the curriculum already. Thank you. Good question, Ramon.
Yeah, and again, Ramon, you know, Cipadino says it's the best. Right, we have elements of boxing, right? And even Chris Kent, right? He says it's the best too. We have elements of boxing, but we're not a boxer, right? We have elements of trapping, but we're not a Wing Chun in the Wing Chun stands doing Wing Chun, right? We have elements of kicking, right? But we're not a Taekwondo guy. We have elements of elbows and knees, right? But we're not Muay Thai guys, right? So we have elements of this and that, but like Super Jitsu said, we just change the eyes and we make it our own, right? If it fits within our structure, how can we make it ours, right? Without having to sacrifice our stance. Meaning, if I throw a rear hand, now look, I sacrifice the stance. I am squared up, right? Or if I have to throw a tool that requires me to switch leads, that's no good, because now my power hand is backwards, my least coordinated hand is forward, right? So that's no good. I can't fit that into our walk. Our structure, and if it's going to compromise my structure, then I shouldn't be using it. Bruce Lee talked about hacking away the non-essentials, right? Steve Carlos, maybe you agree with that as well.
Yes, I agree with Steve James when it comes to the wrestling and obviously the Filipino martial arts, because there are a lot of things that you can take from there, obviously.
Alright guys, so we're more or less around the last 10 minutes of right class. So if you guys have any questions like this, keep asking them myself, James, and Steve Carlos as well. We'll answer them to the best of our ability as well. So just keep the questions coming.
Alright guys, yeah, so we're in the question section. Ask away, whether you're on YouTube or Instagram. I'm gonna have Steve Carlos definitely answer a few because we don't get them every day. But yeah, I mean, what's cool about Jeet Kune Do is it's obviously very efficient on the outside. We've been doing that. We've been beating that to death on the channels. But now today we're talking about the infighting. We may continue to talk about infighting from the clinch, attached, unattached, different kinds of head movement. And what's beautiful about Jeet Kune Do is you can borrow any move that fits your structure, like Steve Carlos was talking about. You just have to use it like a JKD person. Like, even that pillar defense that we were talking about before, it's from boxing originally, but at the end of the day, it's not meant to be used in self-defense for long periods of time. It's there to get you out of danger, out of trouble, and then back to range or back for a more slick fighting position even on the inside. Question?
Yeah, so one of the people here on Instagram are asking, should we avoid grabbing clothes like they do in judo?
So it's different though, because like in judo, right, the kimono is such a sturdy grip. Like, you know, don't forget, I come from a gi background from jiu-jitsu, right? So we would start on the feet and go to the floor. It's a lot of the judo moves that work. But then the second you take the kimono off, you can't grab my t-shirt and do the same thing that you could with a kimono. So we prefer wrestling, which is more no-gi. Some of the stuff with the pants works. Like if someone has jeans on and you're on top of them, that stuff can work. But a lot of the stuff with the actual jackets and the kimonos, people don't wear heavy leather jackets. And a lot of the grips, don't forget, you have to get into the lapel twist, which does not happen with a t-shirt or a hoodie. So it's very different. So we prefer wrestling as opposed to judo.
So Shavanda's asking, can you give more examples on how to bridge a gap, right, when working towards the inside?
There's plenty of ways to bridge the gap. I mean, you can punch your way in, like very simple. Like I'm here, jab, jab, cross, hook, and I'm weaving and stepping in. I can bridge in with a simple straight lead to hook kick, and then I'm in boxing range, right? Guy fires a punch, I parry, shoot, weave, I take the angle and I'm in range. A lot of it's gonna require head movement and some punching, right? So jabbing, slipping, cutting the corner while taking the inside, there's plenty of ways to get there, but when you're in there, you need to know what to do. See, some people, like, they work their entries and they get really, really good at entries, but then they don't know what to do once they're in there. And that's why one of the reasons, like, we always preach to the students, please don't rush, don't feel rushed. This takes time, because don't forget, you gotta learn how to fight in close, attached and unattached, in medium range, long range. And then you gotta learn how to grapple, stand up and on the ground, and understand the weapon. There's a lot of content. And even within that content, there's details and details and details and details and details. So I'm still learning all these years later. I think Carlos would agree, and Steve Temin would certainly agree that we're all still learning even as practitioners. So to think that you have it or that you know it all, that's a big booby trap, and it's gonna do nothing for you, that's positive. So always, always, always have that student mindset of trying to learn more about new things, but also more about the things that you're already familiar with and you already do like.
So Ramon is asking, on the bobbing weave, is there a high risk that a highly skilled fighter can strike with the knees?
Yes. So so what he's asking is, when you duck under, can a knee come up? Well, if you're ducking all the way under like this, you're gonna get hit with something, whether it's an uppercut or a knee. But if I do it that fast, it's a little hard to put your knee up there. Like, and also, I'm not weaving just to weave, I'm weaving because you're hooking. So I'm weaving, my elbows are staying high, and I'm taking the angle. I'm taking the angle, which also clears the knee, because if the knee's coming up the middle, I'm taking the angle. I'm taking the angle. So there's a safe way to do the move, and there's a risky way to do the move. It's another reason why you want to move your feet, and it's another reason if you want to have your pillars up,